Growing up in Brooklyn was everything to me, a melting pot of Caribbean culture. I was one of two American families on my block. I wouldn't trade it for the world. Brooklyn is the place I was meant to be raised. The music of Brooklyn in the 80s, that's when I really became aware of other music outside of my household. You know, so up until then it had been about D-Train and Donna Summer and Diana Ross and Al Green and all of the things that my mom listened to. But once I started to pick up an ear for what was happening outside, it was Shabba Ranks and Barris Hammond and Barrington Levy and Yellow Man and Shelly Thunder and DeNancy, all of this reggae music meant everything to us. And it wasn't until I started listening to radio that I could hear Sugar Hill Gang and Sequence and Dana Dane. Uptown, where I spent time at my grandmother's house, that's where my appetite for hip hop grew. That is where I heard the funky 4+1 More, the Treacherous 3, the Kango Kid, Cold Crush, Curtis Blow, all of those guys. My mom studied at Brooklyn College to become a teacher. And so you weren't really allowed to ask, what does that mean? You had to go to the dictionary and find out for yourself. I had to write essays for everything that I wanted to do, everywhere that I wanted to go. But what that did is it made me expressive in a way that I don't know I would have been able to really tap into. And so I thank her for that. I think in school, it was a very supportive group of people where once we heard hip hop, we all were kind of pushed to want to do our own stuff. So in school, during lunchtime, we would bang on the desk and rap around the table. And that's probably where the calling came from. The first woman was, of course, Sha-Rock from the Funky 4+1 More. But when I heard her voice, it was like, oh, this is great. She's doing it for the women. There were many women after that. Of course, there were Sequence, Sparky D, and Sweet T, and Roxanne Shanté, and the real Roxanne. But when I heard Salt-N-Pepa, I said, oh, I can do it. If there was any one person that I felt was extremely supportive in the journey or the transition of becoming a non-rapper to a rapper, it would be Eric Cole. We met in 7th grade, I think. And then as the years went by, we would still write. To this day, I write my rhymes the way that he wrote his. And I remember him calling me up asking, did I want to start a group? And I was like, okay, let's give it a go. When that didn't go, he called me up and he said, I just got signed to a record label. They're also looking for a female MC. Do you want to come out and meet them? We get there and I have my rhyme book with me and they say, okay, so rap that. And then one particular rhyme, Milk, started banging on the drum machine and he came up with the track right then and there for I Cram to Understand You, which became the first single. So I guess checked all the boxes for what they were looking for a female MC, and the miracle took place. Lyte was my name when I came to them, and I got that from the Dictionary of Thoughts, and it had a lot of positive things that were being said about the word light, and different philosophers had their take on it. And then when I got the first record, MC was in front of it, and it was like, well, we just thought that it was necessary for you to have a title. In that era, it was like 12 of us on the bill for some of these tours that went out. It was Big Daddy Kane and Bismarck and Heavy D and Slick Rick and A Tribe Called Quest and De La Soul and The Fresh Prince and Public Enemy and KRS-One. I think having multiple people on tour gave us the sense of family, but also friendly competition. But the truth, we knew that all of us needed to succeed in order for the tour to do well. So we were always rooting for each other. We were a family. The truth is, as a young kid on the streets of New York, you could not be affected by what you saw. My generation, we all felt some sort of responsibility to our community to either tell them what was happening or speak for them and tell the world what was happening in our communities. For us, it was standard to have many songs on an album that addressed many different topics. So yeah, you could have your party track that made people feel good and, you know, sing along, but then you also had songs that would address topics that were socially charged. Not With a Dealer made sense. Poor Georgie made sense. Eyes of the Soul made sense. I Cram to Understand You made sense, along with a whole slew of other songs that I've done. Me being the first female rapper to have a full-length album, I call it a miracle. Sylvia Rhone had been promoted to a senior position at Atlantic, First Priority Music, also having Audio 2, who had a smash record, top billing. The culmination of everything at the right time then equates to MC Lyte being the first woman to have a full-length album. Roughneck going gold was a huge feat for us at First Priority Music, and also Brooklyn, and also women in hip hop. It was great. I got to tour the world with Janet Jackson, with Teddy Riley and Guy and SWV and Keith Sweat and Shy. We're on the road. We get the call that it's been Grammy nominated. I just remember sitting at Radio City Music Hall. I just was honored to be considered for a nomination. We get to say, two-time Grammy nominee, yada, yada. I wanted to act since I probably was about 7 years old. And so I had a couple of acting gigs. It's an off-Broadway play called The Club 12, based off The 12th Night, which I did with Wyclef and Lauryn Hill and Lisa Nicole Carson and Darren Henson, a beautiful cast of people. And I also did a few movies here and there. Oh, but I decided out of nowhere that I wanted to be a music supervisor. And I did all the music for Keisha Cole and Monica and different shows on BET and ESPN. So I started auditioning again, and I was finally able to executive produce, co-create, and co-write my own sitcom. The sitcom called Partners in Rhyme is loosely based on my life. We make up a family from New York, but now in Los Angeles, and what it means to be an artist turned music executive. It's a lot of fun. It's always been important for me to give back. I started a foundation with Lynn Richardson called Hip Hop Sisters, which to date we've given away over $1 million in scholarships to young people. We have partnerships with Wisconsin-Madison and Dillard University. There's nothing like being able to tell someone you now have the funds to go to college. First off, I don't think I've conceptualized hip hop. It's probably the one thing that I've been a part of in my life, which feels just historically part of something that has been this long. Considered a legend, to me, just means that knows blazing trail and being a pioneer in music and being someone that could inspire more people to be in this business and do what I do. The future for MC Lyte. There's gotta be more giving, more getting to give, more giving to get. And so we make the platform big, we get the incoming funds, we give them to the people and the youth who need it to further their education. I'd like to be remembered as someone who cared, someone who pushed the envelope in terms of being involved with the community and wanting to see change, and also being known for inspiring others to go after their dreams.